Western medicine only follows reductionism. You take a chemical, a part of it, and do what is called RCT, randomized controlled trials, and which we think is the basis of all our scientific medicine, quote-unquote, scientific medicine. What is the science of it? I will come to that later. So this is the difference. So modernity should come from our antiquity. There's an old saying in Latin, respicit prospici. If you want to look forwards, you will look backwards. Even throwing a javelin throw, you don't throw like this. It won't go far. Take it back and throw it, it'll go very far. So go back to our ancient wisdom. Everything that is in the modern science now, I'm not talking the conventional dead Western science of physics, chemistry, and biology. The modern evolutionary science, evolutionary biology, systems biology, which comes to Ayurveda. Quantum physics has almost come to Advaita. And quantum physics has now revolutionized scientific look at what we do. Come back, as so beautifully put by Max Planck, there is no perception without a perceiver. Let us say, I do a work on a rat or a dog and say it is science. If you do on the same rat work, the results will be 40% difference. If a woman does work on the rat and a man does work on the same rat, difference can be 20 to 60%. If you change your pheromone, you just put on a nice scent, whole body you bathe with a very expensive scent and go and do the work, it will be different. The rat has a perception. You have a perception. You have a consciousness, rat has a consciousness, and they interact and the results are totally different. This is very interesting. This shows that all our Western scientific reductionist studies are not true, which is being proved one by one. Like for example, Karthikeyan was talking about cholesterol. I said cholesterol cannot be a disease for the simple reason that if you try to lower your cholesterol, the body will produce more cholesterol. If you try to stop the cholesterol being made, because 90% of the cholesterol is made in your liver, because for your good, let us say you live a very high fly life on the edge of it. You know, you are running after money, you are running after power, you are running after chair. I always tell people, Indians are Peter Jnanis. They may not be Jnana Peters, but they are Peter Jnanis. They know how to sit in the chair and how to get someone out of the chair and occupy the chair. Now come to that level of what is happening now is, we run a life which is full of stress. I want to destroy somebody. I want to take him off that chair and sit there. All this will make you very, very tense. And to save you at that time, to produce more steroids to keep you going, you require more cholesterol. If you don't have cholesterol, you can't make steroid hormones. So body makes more cholesterol for your own good. Otherwise, what you eat, whether you eat grass or you eat beef every 3 times a day, it doesn't matter, because 10% of the cholesterol comes from the food. Actually, 1960, late 60s, we had a BBC big debate on cholesterol. There was one lady, she had a big diary. She gave a challenge to everybody on the television. She said, whatever is your cholesterol level, come to me. I'll give you milk in the morning, milk in the afternoon, milk at night, and get your cholesterol down. At that time, I thought she was foolish, but now I know she is right, because if you feed more cholesterol from outside, your body will produce less cholesterol. See, that's what's called the body's intelligence. Now, anyway, I'm very happy that recently, not recently, 3 years ago, the American government, the USDA, which once in five years it gives its pronouncement, saying that cholesterol is not a disease, so you must eat better, and you must eat more. And they said eggs, bacon and ham are probably the ideal breakfast rather than eating all that junk that you have today. Now this U-turn came after millions of people have suffered from cholesterol-lowering drugs. So let us not in the first place ape everything that is the Western one and think it is modern, and then you say, you call it as a modern science. Now how did science become science, medicine become a science? You know the story? Well, in Europe, so-called modern medicine today started 5,000 years ago as mumbo-jumbo, witchcraft and sorcery on the Nile Valley. It moved from there, went to Arabia. And one man who changed the course of so-called modern medicine today was Ibn Sina, who the Americans call as Avicenna. Avicenna is not his name, he's Ibn Sina. And Ibn Sina had added a lot of sense into the so-called witchcraft of the modern medicine. Then it went to Greece. Greece, of course, it had the influence of Hippocrates and others in Greece. And from then it moved on. And in Europe, 12th century, all churches, most churches became universities overnight. That's why today the gown that you wear for the convocation, the vice chancellor, chancellor, deacon, rector, these are all church terminologies and they have nothing to do with education. They are ecumenical terminologies. So these universities accepted medicine as science. So one fine morning, you become science. You understand that? That's the definition. But surgery was not accepted as science. Up until 1572, when the Royal College of Surgeons of England started, they were called barber surgeons. Even today in the West, when you pass your FRCS, you're not called a doctor, you're called Mr. Or if you're a girl, you're called Miss. And that continues even to this day because British are a great tradition and they believe in their tradition. So you are a barber surgeon. So surgery was not science at all. How did medicine become a science in America? Of course, these Europeans moved on to the New World when the New World was discovered, thanks to India, because Columbus went in search of Indian spices and lost his way and went somewhere and then got that beautiful land for them. So they should be eternally grateful to us for getting that beautiful land, large land, four times the mass of India and one-third the population of India. So they're really enjoying life at our cost. Because he said, yeah, that's why the Indians, American Indians are called Indians. Because he said, they're Indians. He was in Cuba. But he thought he was in probably Calicut. That's the mistake he did. Now coming back to the modern medical evolution after that, America, there were 247 medical colleges around the turn of the last century. They were teaching everything, except Ayurveda. They were teaching everything. The so-called Western medicine, so-called, homeopathy, radioesthesia, chiropractic, osteopathy, and what have you. Now, there are three brilliant men who were very rich in America at that time. Nelson Rockefeller Sr., J.B. Morgan, and Andrew Carnegie. These were rich people. And when you're very rich, I have studied some of these rich people. When you're very rich, you want more power. You go after power. So they had a meeting together one day and said, look, each one of us fighting one another because we want to make more money. We will be rich, but we will not be powerful. So let's have a consortium. Three of us join together and we can control the world. So they joined together into a consortium and got a friend of theirs to advise them as to how to control the world. Of course, initially the advice given was, you fund the First World War, you will control the world. They did that. And when they found out after some time, 15 million white men were dead in the war. If Indians and Africans were dead, nobody would have bothered. So much so in England, no girl had a husband. That's why they were given to spinning. That's why it's called spinster. Because you don't have a husband, you start spinning. So they said 15,000 white men died and so many orphans without fathers and so many girls without husbands. So war is not the best thing to fund. Then they again called this friend, gave him some more money and said, get us a better way of doing. The man said, control education and you will control the world. That was a beautiful idea. And so they said, let's control medical education first. They were already funding 47 medical colleges in America at that time, the three of them together. And they were trying to get control over these, having the board members from their companies on the board. And they influenced the American president at that time because, American presidents were elected by these rich people only. Even today, American presidents are probably elected by the drug companies. In the olden days, oil companies. Today, drug companies are three times more powerful than the oil companies. Their lobby is three times more. So they told the president, you get these medical colleges examined to see which of them are scientific and which are not. So the president said, okay, go ahead. Then they said, whom to now have this commission to? Thank you. They chose a man called Abraham Flexner. The very famous Flexner Report 2010, you must have all read. Abraham Flexner was a retired headmaster of Andrew Carnegie High School. What did he know about medicine? What did he know about science? What did he know about anything? Nothing. So the Flexner goes around 247 medical colleges in 1 year, comes out with a beautiful report which said these 47 medical colleges which are doing chemical drug trials, because they all are from NAFTA, chemical derived now, they are scientific, rest of them are not scientific. So overnight this new system classification started. What did the government do? They didn't do anything. They had no knee-jerk reaction. They published this Flexner report every day in the morning, front page of New York Times, for 1 year. Naturally, the other colleges died a natural death. No student went to them. So from this 47, it became about 99 or so now. And all these are only chemical drug treating medical colleges. That is why Western medicine is chemical drug treating science.